Welcome to Cybersecurity Awareness TV, episode number 418, recorded January 21st, 2023. My name is Mac Jackson Jr. I am your consultant and cybersecurity researcher. If this is the first time you have seen my show, I discuss cybersecurity news, interviews, and tips that you could use today to protect yourself from the fastest growing crimes of the 21st century. I would like to thank everyone that has supported our show over the years here on Cybersecurity Awareness TV, from Russia to China to South Korea, North Korea, everybody from around the world, including the Western states, being a part of our listening audience here on Cybersecurity Awareness TV. If you'd like to find out more about my company, the name of the company is Vanderson Cyber Group. You can go to my website at Vanderson Cyber Group, or you can join us, be a part of our community at MacJacksonJR.com. That's MacJacksonJR.com. Remember, folks, we're on all social media, so remember, when you find one of our social media platforms, go in and share, like, and subscribe. Hit that notification button to be alert of all the different types of cyber tips we can have for you. If you'd like to be a part of our Patreon, folks, we're also on the Patreon channel. If you'd like to support us here at our show, you can find us at patreon.com/MacJacksonJR. In today's episode, we're talking about cybersecurity news. TikTok, folks. TikTok, again, this application is meeting national security events again, folks. There's more and more states are getting rid of TikTok from their employees' smartphones. We're going to talk about that. There's more continuation of the story. In our second segment, we were talking about the FBI warnings. There's FBI warnings, folks, and scams. And folks, this is very, very important. So those of you out there who have children, young folks, it's definitely important that the parents take a look at this particular segment. Something in it for you. In our third segment, we talk about cybersecurity tips and business productivity things that you could use for your company, for your business. In our first segment, folks, cybersecurity news this week. TikTok application, folks. This app is now deemed as a national security threat by the FBI for the United States. The TikTok app, folks, if you haven't been noticing right now, is one of the fastest social media platforms in the United States. The viewers of TikTok have suppressed Facebook and Twitter, being one of the number one apps that people are using. However, there are growing concerns from local, state, and federal governmental entities that the app can be dangerous to the security of the United States. Now, those of you may think, well, how is that possible? How is a little TikTok app of 30 seconds or 60 second TikTok app can cause any harm? Well, the problem, folks, is that apps itself can be harmless and they can be entertaining. However, there are apps that can have malware built into the actual app that can do things like look for other information, personal identifiable information on your device. And according to our law enforcement agencies, TikTok is deemed to be one of those apps that can scan your device and then, of course, send your personal information to nefarious people like nation states such as China. The TikTok app itself is owned by a company called ByteDance in China, and this company deals with Chinese government and suppresses information of their citizens. Now there is a growing concern in the United States of banning TikTok apps from governmental agencies. Now more than 50 states, folks, across our country are banning the TikTok app for their employees and within the Wi-Fi devices, because if this app can acquire personal information of individuals, it could then in turn send this information to China. Now that half of the United States government agencies are doing this, there's more and more increasing this ban to state-owned universities as well, that are now not just governmental agencies, but now state universities are banning the use of TikTok. Now, they ban it from your personal device, meaning that they're saying to students that you can't use TikTok or it's blocked on the university campus's Wi-Fi. Now, if you have your own personal device, you can still utilize it. It's your freedom to have your own phone. However, if you're using a university's Wi-Fi, they will ban the use of TikTok. Now, this is interesting. Before we get into our stories here, I just want to let you guys know, isn't it interesting that China is actually doing this to their citizens as well. They are banning certain sites that their citizens cannot have access to through Wi-Fi. And in turn, we're looking to do the same thing from a company. So in this report, we're going to talk about the ban, and we're going to talk about some of the things that TikTok are negotiating with our United States government to try to come up with some sort of a compromise in this application that is now expanded across our country. Our story comes from NBC News Today Show.
For more than 100 million Americans, it's become the go-to social media app for the latest viral dance, fashion, or recipe trends.
I'm not rich enough to know what to do with this.
But amid growing fears, user data could find its way into the hands of the Chinese government.
Not allowed to post TikToks anymore.
The University of Texas in Austin joining a growing list of schools blocking TikTok on campus Wi-Fi networks, citing TikTok's owner, the Chinese company, ByteDance. UT explaining the measure is intended to eliminate risks to information contained in the university's network and to our critical infrastructure.
As a creator, I'm a little bit annoyed.
With 12,000 TikTok followers, UT sophomore Genesis Pieri calls herself a micro-influencer.
My hair determines what my makeup is going to look like.
A lot of the influencers that I grew up watching, they didn't look like me.
Now she fears her push for representation could be cut short, with her student audience no longer able to communicate as freely.
How concerned are you about a foreign entity essentially spying?
It's something that is in the back of my head, like, what are they doing with this data if they do have it?
And it's not just colleges. At least 31 states, including Texas, have enacted some sort of TikTok ban, mainly on government-owned phones and computers. The U.S. House of Representatives even banning the app on any House-issued devices. Last month, the head of the FBI citing safety concerns for TikTok users, including the potential manipulation of recommendation algorithms.
Which are a lot more worrisome in the hands of the Chinese Communist Party than whether or not you're steering somebody, you know, as an influencer to one product or another.
But TikTok says it doesn't store U.S. user data in China or share information with the Chinese government, writing, "We're disappointed that so many states are jumping on the political bandwagon to enact policies that will do nothing to advance cybersecurity in their states and are based on unfounded falsehoods about TikTok."
So, Morgan, as you said, we've seen TikTok banned on federal devices, and now we've got this school trend that's impacting everyday people. So is this the beginning, you think, of a wider ban?
Yeah, Hoda, potentially. We do know that there is bipartisan legislation that was discussed in December that would not only ban TikTok potentially, but other apps with social media that could be tied to Russia and or several other foreign countries that the government considers concerning. In the meantime, we're told by TikTok that they've been in ongoing negotiations with the federal government for more than 2 years and that, quote, positive progress is being made. And we're also hearing from lawmakers who say that there is another solution, and that would be the sale to an American company to keep TikTok operating here in the U.S. without all of these growing amount of concerns. Hoda?
All right, Morgan Chesky for us there in Austin. Morgan, thanks.
Well, folks, now that TikTok is under a microscope for possibly security violations within social media, being one of the giant social media platforms out there, TikTok is looking to negotiate with U.S. legislators in developing a plan to have a U.S.-based company support the TikTok rather than having it done by ByteDance from China. Now, what does this mean? Well, this means that rather than having the databases and the control of the data mining, if you would, and all the data that's collected by the TikTok apps, we would have it done here in the U.S. versus having it done overseas. We can have more control over it. But again, is that enough? That is something that's being negotiated now with a legislator. So it's interesting to see that they, meaning TikTok and the United States IT Cybersecurity Division, that's what we really need to have to look at this, not our politicians, folks, because a lot of our politicians don't even know how to log into their PCs right now, right? So it has to be done by qualified people in our government dealing in cybersecurity, working with these legislators and with TikTok to make sure that if the company here in the United States has the databases and that are monitoring it, they are not subvertingly sending data to nation states as a decoy or a Trojan horse, if you would. The story continues on this particular negotiation with U.S. legislators through the Wall Street Journal. Here's a report.
This is your tech news briefing for Wednesday, January 18th. I'm Zoe Thomas for the Wall Street Journal. TikTok is in the midst of negotiations with U.S. regulators to keep the app operating here. For the last 2 years, U.S. officials have said they're worried that TikTok's ownership by Beijing-based ByteDance could give China access to American data, or allow it to influence what U.S. users see on the app. And as you may remember, that's led to threats that TikTok could be banned in the U.S. To prevent this, TikTok is trying a new tactic for negotiations: increased transparency. Here with me to discuss what lawmakers and regulators are learning about the company and how it could affect TikTok's chances of staying in the U.S. is our reporter, Georgia Wells. Hey, Georgia, welcome back to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So, Georgia, you've been speaking with people familiar with these conversations between TikTok and regulators. What new information is the company sharing?
So we're learning a lot more about what these conversations look like and what TikTok has been doing for the past 2 years. And so this involves $1.5 billion effort so far to set up a new structure that would be in charge of making sure that the algorithms involved with the app and that data is safe. And this is their attempt to convince U.S. lawmakers that TikTok could operate in the U.S. safely.
What exactly are they proposing to change?
So TikTok has said that all of the systems it has related to serving content to users and determining which videos to take down, that those systems would be housed with Oracle, and the code that runs those systems would be visible both to Oracle and to third-party monitors. And those third-party monitors could check the code to detect whether it had been manipulated, perhaps by the Chinese government or other foreign actors. And that if they see anything that concerns them, there are stipulations within this proposal where they would have a way to escalate their concerns, flag them to the U.S. government, and ultimately the U.S. government could shut them down if it felt that the concerns weren't taken seriously.
Why has it changed its approach? Why is it sharing more now?
So typically these conversations are confidential. It's between TikTok and this entity called CFIUS, which is the Committee on Foreign Investment in the U.S. And this is an executive branch panel that kind of looks at whether or not apps can remain in the U.S. safely and also related to their ownership. And TikTok has been talking to CFIUS for 2 years, but there's not really a deal in sight right now. So people close to TikTok are at this point where they want to show what they've been working on in an attempt, hopefully, to find allies in Washington who could help encourage a deal to happen.
We've seen some bans at state and federal level. Can you tell us a bit about those, and are they playing a role in how these conversations are changing?
Technically, that process is different than this process, but yes, that kind of has this overall ratcheting up the urgency for TikTok right now when you've got all of these local politicians who are talking about TikTok as a risk. And so that increases the urgency for TikTok to want to get a deal done at the federal level to be able to show that they're working on addressing these issues.
Right. I mean, lawmakers, state and federal, and regulators have raised these concerns about TikTok's data being shared with China or maybe China influencing what American users see. But beyond that theoretical threat, is there any reason why lawmakers are wary?
So weeks ago, we learned that TikTok conducted this internal probe to find that employees had misused their authority to access the data of journalists on the platform. And this was in an effort to identify leaks of company information. So that obviously is not doing TikTok any favors when the company is trying to convince lawmakers that it would never abuse the data of its users. Basically, part of the challenge here is that TikTok's own executives in the U.S. have not always completely understood how the algorithms in the app worked. And so back in 2020, there was a group of TikTok executives who noticed that videos for certain creators suddenly were seeing this big drop in the number of views they were getting. and they had no idea what had happened. And they like ask around and nobody in the U.S. knows what's going on. And then they talk to colleagues in China and they learned that there was a tweak that TikTok's algorithm team in China implemented, changed certain aspects of content that was shown to users, and that this inadvertently really reduced the amount of political content that users were shown. And so this kind of showed an example of TikTok could face perhaps an uphill battle in proving that U.S. executives would always understand fully what the app is doing and be in a position to catch anything that can like be tweaked with the app and know what's going on. When we asked TikTok about the incident, a spokeswoman said that political content was very popular on the app in 2020. And she said that the hashtags Trump, Biden, Trump 2020, and Biden 2020 garnered more than 2 trillion cumulative views monthly at that time.
Right. I mean, those are the sort of big concerns. And as you say, they're certainly not helping TikTok in these negotiations. What is TikTok saying then about this kind of change of tactic of sharing more information with regulators in these negotiations?
So TikTok is at this point where there's not a deal in sight. And so now the company basically wants to show more of its homework. The company wants to show that it has been trying to address these issues, that it's working on it, so that in the very least, when lawmakers are talking about the concerns, they'll be armed with more of the facts around what the company has been doing in an attempt to address this.
It sort of feels like we're hitting this inflection point in a way. Lawmakers are paying more attention to social media. The government seems to have leverage over TikTok because of its ownership. But how come other social media platforms aren't having to offer up changes to their platforms or reveal their algorithms to regulators?
So these conversations are about national security. And so that means the data of the users on the app and also the content that can be shown to them. And so we are also, like you mentioned, at a time when a lot of lawmakers in the U.S. have concern about the role of tech in our lives and the role of algorithms and perhaps like addiction to apps. But this isn't the venue for discussing that. Like the venue that we're talking about right now is just about national security.
You mentioned there's no deal in sight right now, but then what happens next and how quickly can we expect a resolution to this issue?
So that's the big question. Potential outcomes could include the U.S. forcing TikTok to divest, so basically sell off a portion of its operations. Another potential outcome is there's a bill winding its way through Congress right now that seems like it could ban TikTok. But also we've seen TikTok remain on phones and just have this issue kind of percolating in the background for a long time. So I don't know how much longer that could continue. But the million-dollar question right now is what's going to happen to TikTok in the U.S.? Because this is something that would affect millions and millions of users.
Yeah, I guess millions of users will be watching to see if they can keep that app on their phone. Georgia Wells, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
And that's it for today's Tech News Briefing. For more tech stories, head over to our website, wsj.com. I'm Zoe Thomas for The Wall Street Journal. Thanks for listening.
Folks, criminals are always looking for vulnerabilities to attack our American citizens across our country and around the world. Remember, folks, you need to protect yourself and your organization by having proper cybersecurity training to avoid these type of threats. You can find out more about this story of TikTok by going to my blog. I have an in-depth discussion about TikTok and why you should think about maybe taking it off your phone and telling your children not to utilize this app. There are other alternatives, folks, that you can utilize that will give you the same sort of enjoyment you would from TikTok, but is safer. You can find out more by going to my blog at macjacksonjr.com/max-blog. We'll be right back, folks, after these messages.
Hi, I'm George Miklos.
Hi, I'm Rick Upchurch.
Hi, I'm Aaron Phillips, and we are
The Roundtable.
Check us out
Thursdays at 4 p.m. Pacific Time Live
on Facebook page as well as WWDB-TV.
Hello, folks. This is Mac Jackson Jr. from Vanderson Cyber Group. The problem with businesses today is that they are affected by cyber attacks from around the world, but companies are not sure of what to do. Normally, they are reactive instead of proactive. But folks, cyber attacks can affect your bottom line and will affect you financially, legally, and your business reputation.
Here at Vanish the Cyber Group, we can help you develop a policy by training your employees on what to do if they are involved in a cyber attack and how to mitigate it and fight against it. Folks, we call it here hashtag stay cyber woke. And that's Vanish the Cyber Group here in Las Vegas and around the world. You can reach me, folks, at vanishthecybergroup.com or my website, macjacksonjrjr.com as well. Here locally, 702-868-0808. Give us a call today, folks. We must fight back. Hi, folks. Welcome back to Cybersecurity Awareness TV. I'm your host, Mac Jackson Jr. In this segment, we will discuss FBI warnings for consumers on consumer scams. Folks, this week we are talking about a very serious consumer scam that the FBI are warning everyone to be aware of. Men, women, children, boys, and girls. And it's called sex trafficking. It's a sex extortion that companies and criminals are doing to scam individuals from their money using technology, folks. This is when victims are being victimized by social engineering to send nude photos, and then themselves are sent to predators that the victim doesn't even know about that would in turn blackmail them for monies. In other words, folks, this could be your child, this could be an older adult, anyone. Now you may think, well, how does this happen? No one's going to send sex pictures or nude pictures of people that they don't know. Correct. You're right. Logically speaking, you will never meet someone online and send them a nude picture of yourself. Absolutely. However, it does happen. But here's another way that people are doing it. Hackers will hack into an individual's phone or device using the techniques that we've discussed on this show, and you may have heard from cybersecurity awareness researchers, to acquire access to your smartphone. Now, people have their smartphones, young people particularly, and will take nude photos or photos that really, even let's say it, folks, photos that may not even be moral, right? They're taking these pictures and are saving on their phone, just thinking that they will be the only ones to have access to these particular photos. Well, the hacker, in turn, will get access to their smartphone, see these photos, download them, and then send the victim an email stating that they have these nude photos from their phone, and unless they pay money, they will let all their friends and family know about these pictures. And a lot of times, folks, they'll doctor the photos, they will do things like deep fake with these photos to really make them look illicit and to threaten the actual victims. It's crazy, folks, that our technology that we have in our society that's meant for the good of society, that there are negative people out there that are using this technology for bad things. Folks, I have a story to show you that I'd like to tell you about more on this types of sextortions that are happening across the country that FBI warns us about. Here's a story from WGN News.
Tonight, officials are warning sextortion scams are on the rise, where victims are blackmailed into sending sexual images to adults who are posing as teens, and they usually target males between 15 and 17 years old. Bayless Park Police Detective Ross Chibi is joining us now with more on the warning. Detective, thanks for being with us. I think at this point in time, we're getting more and more familiar with this crime here, but take us through it. How typically does this happen, and why do you think it is happening more often now?
So usually this is happening more often because there are more and more social networking websites, apps, and things like that where victims are able to interact with and communicate with potential offenders on the internet.
But why, I mean, typically, I know you have some commonalities that exist between the victim here and the suspect. Can you take us through some of that? Because I think it's really important for families to know that.
Absolutely. So most often, the offender and the victim will meet just through normal communication on these apps or websites. And at some point, the offender will ask for compromising pictures of the victim. And then once they have those, they will use those to extort the victim for, you know, financial gain by threatening to share those pictures with colleagues, family, et cetera, on other social media sites. So usually it starts very innocent and it's, you know, just a normal communication. And then these offenders know how to ratchet that up and eventually compromise the victim.
How difficult is it to investigate these crimes when a lot of the culprits are overseas somewhere? And, you know, it's a very sensitive issue where I'm guessing a lot of the victims just don't report these crimes to police.
I do think that these crimes go unreported a lot of the time. Our ability to investigate them depends on a couple things. One, how quickly the incident is reported to your local law enforcement agency. And the other thing is the amount of information you're able to provide to that agency, screen names, user accounts, app information that helps that investigation along so that that could be followed up and possibly identified with an offender.
How often do you catch these guys, and what's your most critical advice to parents as we wrap it up?
It varies just based on the different investigations. My advice to parents would be just to, you know, try to monitor what kind of apps your children are on and who they're communicating on with those. And then just try to have that open dialogue so they know that if there's some sort of compromising situation, they don't take that next step and pay the offender. Just that just makes this whole situation worse, and it just continues the whole process. So as soon as there's something that's compromising, end that communication there and go to local law enforcement.
All right, Detective Ross Chibi with Palos Park Police. Thanks for being with us tonight.
Thank you.
Okay.
As you can tell, folks, this type of extortion and blackmail is definitely on the increase, so definitely be careful. Now, some of the things you may do to protect yourself, we'll talk about that at the end of this segment. But folks, it is on the rise and it's ever increasing of these types of attempts by hackers and scammers to get your information. These scammer folks are definitely indeed predators to get your information. Now, we talked about two ways they can get your information, right? By going in and hacking into your smart device, and you have pictures that you felt and you thought were safe and secure under your device that have been exposed and copied and taken away from them, right? But there's also younger people, folks, that meet someone online that they think that there's someone that they like or are attracted to or have befriended, and they will send them these types of pictures. And of course, they can be also blackmailed or catfished as well. Especially young men are also running into this catfishing thing when they are thinking they're sending photos to the opposite sex and it turns out it's a catfish. Things definitely to be protected of. And we, again, after our next story, we'll talk about some precautions you could take from this. But to continue this story, let's take a look from ABC News 7 from Chicago.
That's right, sextortion attempts are skyrocketing. In fact, the FBI says in 2018, victims lost $83 million to all electronic extortion schemes, criminals scaring you into handing over money. We do want to warn you that some of the material in this story may be sensitive. Pay up or else.
We really do see people spending $50,000.
It's an intimidating threat which could be in your inbox.
The email is going to threaten you and say, we have this compromising information about you. If you don't pay us, we will then tell all of your friends and family about this.
That's right. If you don't pay, alleged X-rated video and pictures of you will be blasted out to your family, friends, coworkers, and boss, or posted on social media. The FBI calls it sextortion.
Sextortion is absolutely on the rise.
FBI data from one recent month shows an additional 13,000 complaints about the sextortion scam, and Chicago's trust wave is also seeing a spike.
In our global security report, we found that sextortion type of spam emails are up 10%. In fact, the year prior, they were 0%.
TrustWave provided the I-team with this real sextortion email. The hacker saying he wants $1,000 or he'll release webcam video of a victim. In 2018, overall electronic extortion complaints rose 242%, with total losses of $83 million.
As far as sextortion is concerned, never give the money.
If you give them money, the request very likely will not stop. So before you send them money, contact the FBI.
The FBI says many times the extortionist is lying about having that compromising material.
It was very automated. They craft one email, it cost them zero to do that. But the fear and anxiety it causes people, whether they may be guilty of such activities or not, it puts them at alarm and they may pay.
Other times, fake pictures are doctored or cyber trolls on dating apps are truly collecting private pictures and videos, even recording you while you are on FaceTime or Skype.
People think that they're in control of the situation when they're online, that they are anonymous, but they are not. It's very easy to get other people's information online. You can quickly fall prey, and what you thought was once under your control can quickly spiral out of control.
Sextortion is not always about the money. According to this criminal complaint, a 15-year-old Wisconsin girl told authorities that she met 43-year-old convicted murderer William Calderon of Cicero online. The girl said if she didn't do as Calderon demanded, he would send nude photos of her to her friends and family. The complaint alleges that Calderon blackmailed the girl into meeting him in person and that on 5 separate occasions he raped her. Calderon faces more than 70 years in prison and is fighting the charges in an upcoming jury trial.
We are in the middle of a large campaign to get the word out on sextortion. We want to let people know it's not their fault. The sextortionist is breaking the law. You are a victim, and we are here to support you.
Criminals can also sextort you if they obtain your phone or a cloud sign-in to your photos. So one way to protect yourself is to not store sensitive or embarrassing pictures online or on mobile devices. Overall, experts warn about sending those private pictures to anyone at all, even someone you trust, because you never know where it'll go.
That money, paid out in extortion is staggering.
Yeah, it's a lot of money and never pay. Yeah.
Folks, as you can see, this is a very serious matter that the FBI warns parents about this types of blackmail that can affect their children and also adults as well. But folks, some things that you could do is definitely talk to your children about taking photos that are inappropriate on their smart devices and sending them to other people or taking these inappropriate devices in general. The best thing to do is not to do it at all. Take these types of photos. But again, you're talking about teenagers and they may see a need to do this sort of thing, but letting them know that this can follow them around forever. They apply for a job 10 years later. If this information is out there on the internet, it is out there forever. So definitely talk to your children, and I would even suggest definitely monitor their social media devices and what they're utilizing. If you suspect any types of threats of blackmail or affecting your family or you as an individual, definitely report these attempts of extortion to your local authorities right away. As a cybersecurity consultant, we here on Cybersecurity Awareness TV believe in training and educating individuals as well as businesses on these types of attacks and what to do and how to protect yourselves from them. You could definitely find out more by going to my website at Mac Jackson Jr. Jr. Folks, always folks, hashtag stay cyber alert. We'll be back after these messages.
Hello, folks. This is Mac Jackson Jr. from Vanderson Cyber Group. The problem with businesses today is that they are affected by cyber attacks from around the world, but companies are not sure what to do. Normally, they are reactive instead of proactive. But folks, cyber attacks can affect your bottom line and will affect you financially, legally, and your business reputation. Here at Vanderson Cyber Group, we can help you develop a policy by training your employees on what to do if they are involved in a cyber attack and how to mitigate it and fight against it. Folks, we call it here hashtag stay cyber woke. And that's Vanderson Cyber Group here in Las Vegas and around the world. You can reach me, folks, at VandersonCyberGroup.com or my website, MacJacksonJrJr.com as well. Here locally, 702-868-0808. Give us a call today, folks. We must fight back.
Hi, I'm Judy Mario. I invite you to watch my show, What's Your Story with Judy Mario on WWDB TV, where I interview celebrities, doctors, authors, professional speakers, and just plain folks like you and me. So watch my show, and also watch some of the other great shows that we have here on WWDB-TV, and you can also find us on Roku.
Hello, folks. Welcome back to Cybersecurity Awareness TV. I'm your host, Mac Jackson Jr. In this segment, we talk about business tips, things you can do to improve the productivity and security of your business. And folks, in this segment, in the future, you will be able to see me interview other people that talk about their business, ways that you could be more productive and secure their businesses as well. But in this segment this week, I will tell you one of our mottos is think before you click. That's right, folks. Sounds very, very simple. Think before you click. You get that text message on your phone. You're not sure where it comes from. Before you click on it, see if you can contact the actual sender and verify this is a text message that you're looking for. And folks, as I'm telling you this, even today on the way to the studio, I got a text message from one of my friends on Instagram. And Instagram started with a very interesting introduction. Hey, Mac. How you doing? Hope things are going well. Well, this person that I talked to wouldn't necessarily say that. First of all, they wouldn't send me a text message on Instagram. I would send them directly from a phone number that we have. We would text that way. It's safer, and we know that his number is secure, my number is secure, right? So I wouldn't get that. So I said, hey, I'm doing fine. How are you doing? And they wrote back, yeah, I'm doing really good, Mac. Man, we got to get together and talk sometime. Hey, by the way, there is this new grant that the United States government has put out, and here's a link to it. You may even want to check it out to help your business. I thought, wow, this is really interesting. Tell me more, right? Because I want them to give me more information on it. So they sent me some additional, you know, oh, you need to check this out. This is really, really good. You know, click on it, let me know, and let's get together and talk about it. So I have these screenshots. So I'm going to send them to my friend and let him know that his Instagram account was again hijacked. So that's, I'm noticing a trend in that from Facebook to Instagram, accounts being hijacked by hackers or just, you know, a-hole people. Thank you. I'll put it that out there that got information out there, and they're taking a copy of your profile and creating a fake profile to try to convince your particular friends in clicking on a link because you feel comfortable knowing that you get a link from your friend, it should be safe. Definitely be careful out there, folks. Remember, always think before you click. These are some of the things that we have for you, and we'll have a lot more every week for you regarding things you could do on cybersecurity and business productivity, right? From my other friends and business associates. We'll be talking about that in upcoming weeks as well. That's all we have for you this week, folks. Again, this is Mac Jackson for Vanderson Cyber Group. You can find me on MacJacksonJr.com. It's MacJackson.com, folks. Hey, folks, definitely stay careful out there. And remember, hashtag stay cyber alert. See you next week. We'll be right back.